And good morning and welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us today. What a great rainstorm Friday night, huh? It was absolutely awesome, man. I slept good, for I had the door open, could hear the rain, woke up a few times, and it never quit all night. It was terrific. Some folks at 8 o'clock service said over one whole inch, all right? So we'll take it. We might not have had a miracle March, but we're going to have an awesome April, all right? So that's absolutely terrific. We're glad you're with us today. If you are a guest, it might be your first time here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to take one. Fill it out. Let us know of your presence today. We promise we're not going to irritate you by knocking on your door or bothering you on a phone, but we'd like to send some information in the mail that tells you what goes on around here, what we believe, and maybe answer most of the questions that you might have. So thank you for doing that. Those cards are also for our regular church family members. If you have prayer requests or messages to any of the church staff, you can do it there. And on Tuesday, we'll see that those things get addressed very, very quickly. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some updates on several prayer requests. This coming Tuesday, if you are a prime timer, that means 55 or older, you don't have to be retired. Okay? And quite frankly, we don't card anybody at the entrance. Okay? If you are simply 55 or older, come and enjoy lunch with folks from the congregation. You'd meet them in a way that you never would. You might actually find out you have a friend who attends a different service, and you all show up for lunch together. If you've never been before, your first time, just show up. You don't need to bring anything. If you're a regular, you know what the routine is. If you are a first-time person, may I suggest, get your dessert first, because everybody else does, okay? So just a suggestion there. But that will be on Tuesday. Next weekend is Women's Retreat. All right, Women's Retreat. They're going up to Calvin Crest. I think it's probably too late if you haven't signed up by now. So check with Fawn. She might give you directions on that. Hey, we got some ladies wearing some T-shirts in here today. Would you ladies stand? All right, would you ladies stand? Who wants to be bold? Who wants to be a bold warrior? Tell us why you're wearing that T-shirt today.
We just finished a 10-week Bible study on fervent prayer. So we've learned how to pray fervently over different areas of our life that really matter to us.
48 women on Saturday mornings. All right, wonderful, terrific. Ladies, thank you, thank you, thank you. And we are glad you are our warriors for all of us as well. So thank you so much for doing that. And thanks for wearing those shirts today. Notice that on May 1st, there's going to be a Mexico Mission Night. More information to come soon. Next Sunday, it's Roundup Rodeo Sunday, all right? So what that means is after the third service, lunch is provided here at the church. Everything's provided. Man, we got the Sharton boys who are going to be here again, and they're doing the barbecue tri-tips out on the grill. They'll be fresh and hot and sliced right here. And your elder board and staff will be serving you. So show back up about 12:15 and get in line. And there's also going to be homemade chili, because there's a chili cook-off. If any of you have just a killer chili recipe, why don't you enter a pot of your chili in the contest? Take out a card in the pew in front of you, write your name and your phone number on it or email, and this will be your last day to enter in the chili cook-off. They will contact you with the directions on what time to have it here, and all the sampling is going to be done before lunchtime, so that then we can put the pots out and people can have some really, really good chili, all right, along with their tri-tip sandwiches and chips and beverages that are provided, all right. Also, on chili cook-off Sunday, on Roundup, you can tell what I'm thinking about right now, on Roundup Sunday, Eric Olson would like to meet with those of you who last week, there were 12 of you, he was looking for six, but 12 of you signed up to potentially help with childcare for Celebrate Recovery. And so he would like to meet with those of you who signed up. You weren't saying you were fully committed, but you wanted to investigate. So he's going to have about a 15-minute meeting over lunch, I think, with you next Sunday afternoon. So if you can make it, and we'll give you more information next Sunday about that. Speaking of Celebrate Recovery, Raylene shared, with permission, I'm sharing this, but Raylene, and not everybody knows Raylene, but you know her husband, Randy Robinson, he plays piano for us, and she shared at Celebrate Recovery her testimony last Thursday night here at New Hope, and I had the privilege of being here. And what a wonderful testimony of what God has done in her life. And I share that with only her permission, because there's a saying at Celebrate Recovery, what happens here stays here, here, here. All right? But with permission, she allowed me to share that. And I'm doing that because I want you to also pray for her. She is going to be sharing that testimony with a much larger Celebrate Recovery. Ours was about 48 that night, I think, or 50. And she's going to be doing it with a Celebrate Recovery this coming Thursday at North Point. I mean, Wednesday, for about 200. So please be praying for her, because these are the first two times in her life she has made that bold step to share how God has been at work with her hurts, her habits, and the hang-ups. So we are so grateful for that. Prison Fellowship, they are in need of some things in their No More Blues closet. This is for men and women who recently are released from prison, and they have some immediate needs for clothes and items. And if you have some things in your closet that you can get rid of and that would be useful, all right? Sometimes we have things in our closet that we need to get rid of that are not useful, okay? Then do the appropriate thing. Throw them away, okay? But if you have some things which are still very, very useful, all right, then it would be wonderful. You can bring them next Sunday to the pavilion, and they would appreciate that so very, very much. Last Wednesday night was the kickoff for our new JAMS. That's our Toddlers Through Sixth Grade Kids program. It will meet, I believe it's 10 consecutive weeks from April 6th to May 18th. Maybe that's 8 weeks. And it's not too late. If you didn't get your kids here last week, start bringing them next Wednesday night. It's a wonderful ministry. They have games, they have snacks, but most of all, they get taught about Jesus Christ. And this time, they're studying the parables of Christ. At that same time, from 7 to 8, is a great thing for parents and or grandparents. It's called Smart Kids, Smart Money. Smart Money, Smart Kids. This is a Ramsey financial piece geared just for families that have small children and how to begin to teach your kids an appropriate use of funds. There is a cost for that, but if that's prohibitive for you, we've had some scholarships given that could be of assistance. So don't let cost prevent you from taking that class. And it started last week, but it's not too late. This week would be great for you to enter that. Secret Church Simulcast. There's some information in your bulletin about that. This is an absolute terrific in-depth study. It goes on for 6 hours. 3:30 in the afternoon till 9:30 at night. It's going to be done in the bridge. We did this last year. This is intense. This is rapid fire. This is done by the Director of Missions and Outreach for the Southern Baptist and Lifeway. This guy is a pistol. He takes most current critical issues that have relationship to the body of Christ in the world, and he addresses them. Last year, it was the subject of human sexuality and the will of God and the direction of Scripture. And let me tell you, he had threats on his life. Okay, he literally had to go into a secret place to teach the class because there are churches all around, but it was being simulcast out of Birmingham, Alabama. This year, he's going to be talking about Christ in the midst of world religions. How does Christ... what does he have to say as we face the growing climate of world religions? And it should be very, very good. It's $10. You get a nice packet of material, some fill-in-the-blank things, and it's really very, very good. How many of you have already taken the time to read about Heinz Hospice request for wedding gowns? Okay, a few of you did. Fawn, anything you want to say about this?
Just it's an organization here in town, several churches. What they do is they take wedding gowns, and they make burial gowns for babies that have born prematurely or died soon after birth for families. They need like 30 or 40 a month, so it's quite frequently. And this was just brought to our attention. We just thought it was a beautiful way of giving back. I know wedding dresses are very sensitive to women. They're hard for us to give up for whatever reason, I don't know. But they are. And I struggled with it too, because I wanted to do it because I've lost a grandchild, and I thought what a beautiful blessing it would have been to my kids at the time of his death if somebody had offered this beautiful gown. And because, believe it or not, having to decide what to bury your baby in is a hard decision. And if something is given as a gift, it's a tremendous blessing. So I wanted to donate my dress because we always hope our daughter's going to wear it, which they sell.
They're not.
They hang in the closet for years, and when I tried it on, I actually got sentimental again, thinking, "Ooh, do I want to get rid of this?" But then it occurred to me the wedding dress was materialistic. I still have my husband. Yeah. So I decided to let it go, as Disney would say. say. And it's just a real blessing for everybody involved. It's a blessing for you to give something for such a special purpose. So having said all that, I'm sorry to go on time. If you are interested in donating your wedding dress at any point, just contact me and I will make arrangements to pick it up and get it delivered. That's all you have to do. You won't have to do anything else, but thank you for doing that. If your daughters or you know anybody else who would be interested in doing that, just thank you.
Fawn's phone number is in there under that announcement. And yeah, most of you ladies probably have your wedding dress in a box underneath your bed, in your closet. Hasn't probably been opened in 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, whatever your anniversary are years. Ma's may have gotten to part of it by now, but it'll still be a lot of it will be useful. All right. And so it's a great, great way to recycle for a very good cause. All right, let me give you some updates, all right, on some health issues in our church. Marna Fair, Rich Smith, our counseling pastor here at the church, his mom is now under hospice care, and they would appreciate you remembering to pray for them. His sister is out from back east and is helping to provide some care as well. Polly Good is still going through cancer treatment. She's not able to get out much, so continue to pray for her. Joni Jarbo, who is in service with us today, though she spent 15 hours in ER this week, and she is doing better, but continue to pray for her. But her more important prayer request is for her daughter. We've prayed for her in the past. She's the one, if you'll remember, was pregnant and found cancer. And so baby's been delivered. Grandbaby's doing good. Joni's going up to help provide care this coming week as her daughter goes through some more extensive treatment. So please be remembering to pray for them. Kelly Dunkel from our church family. We told you of this several months ago, the surprise pregnancy. All right. And things are tough for her right now. She's been in and out of the hospital three times. With some rather excessive bleeding. She's now pretty much reduced to bed rest 24/7. She is at home, but please remember to pray for them. They want them to go a couple of more weeks. Most of you probably saw the news or it's come through the grapevine, but a woman from our church, Jan Patton, is the woman in Clovis, if you didn't get the name, that was stabbed 9 times the first part of the week. And this was a renter that she had just rented a room to the day before. She lost her spleen. The stabbings nicked her lungs, her intestines, her liver. She was intubated for the first 4 days in ICU. We were told by family and the doctor on Friday, this is the way they're saying it, this will be a slow recovery, but it will be a full recovery. All right, so we're grateful for that, but this is challenging. So she still, as of yesterday, was in ICU. Continue to remember Jan. There are several from our church family and her small group and CR who have been by to see her and to pray with her. Chad Evans, we found out in the last service last Sunday, Chad and his wife Megan have been Sunday school teachers here in our church. They've been very active members for the last 5 or 6 years. Chad was in the hospital during Easter week. We did not know this. He had a virus attack his heart. And so he was in the hospital 4 or 5 days. He's not back to work yet. Probably Monday, probably tomorrow. Had an MRI to see what damage has been done to his heart, but the infection is cleared out, and he is feeling better and stronger, and so we're grateful for that. Charlotte Berg, I just got this word between services. Charlotte Berg's mom passed away. She was 90-plus. And the call that one of our church family got was, it was a blessing, but just letting you know. So pray for the Berg family. Helen Heath, I understand you were in the hospital again. Okay, you're going to be put on detention, okay? If we don't start getting called a little bit sooner, all right? You cheated us of praying for you, all right? But you look wonderful today, so I'm through scolding you. And if you're visiting, I don't do that often. All right, just I don't do that often. Thank you all. I want to say personally a thank you to all of you who responded to an email I sent out for needing some help this week here at the church. We had 2 memorial services Thursday and Friday, both connected to families in our congregation, and you all responded very well to volunteer for setup, for cleanup, for providing food when it was necessary. When you get 2 back-to-back like that, we have a list, all right, of volunteers who've said, hey, call me at moments like that, but when they're back-to-back, and we just had one last week, we really try not to wear you out, and so we say thanks. So actually, that prompted us to say, we're going to send around a sign-up sheet today. One of the ladies who volunteered on Saturday, by the way, she brought a homemade apple pie. Homemade crust was phenomenal. I told her I thought we needed one about Wednesday of next week. But it was her first time to come and share. She said, thanks for the email. I was happy to do it. She said, I'm retired now, so call me anytime. Well, we didn't know that, all right? So maybe there's some others of you who say, hey, you'd be willing. That doesn't mean when we call you, you always have to say yes. Okay, we understand. We don't know what's going on in your world at the time we call. We just know what's going on in our world here trying to help families. But if we have a name and a number, then we and an email is most important. We can send those out to people who say, yeah, please give me a call. This also includes men, okay, because sometimes we need help clean up afterwards. It's very helpful to the ladies who are here that have done the setup and have serve the meal, and so to move tables and chairs, if we get a couple of guys, it's available. That gets done very, very quickly, usually not more than about half an hour. So if you could be available for that, just put your name and contact information on here. That would be helpful. And also on here is the Uganda mission trip donations. It went around last week. Many of you responded. We're just going to send that around again one more time. I know that the Davis family says thank you to all of you for your help, and also the Shaw family, and both of them actually are sitting back there almost on the same row, and they're here today. So they say thank you for helping with honoring their mom and their dad by the care that you at New Hope gave to them. I think those are all the updates I've been handed. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our tithes and our offering. Well, they're coming. I know sometimes, I don't know if you all get tired. Sometimes I hear, you know, folks don't want to hear all those prayer requests. You all can let me know if you don't. But we're family. It's kind of why this part's called Life in the Church. And there's three services. You don't get to see other folks, and they don't get to see you. And after a couple of weeks in a bulletin, we stop kind of recognizing them, you know, the names. We sort of go right over them, and I know how important it was for me when I was down that you all, you know, reached out and touched base and let me know you were praying. And I just think that's part of what church family is all about. So anyway, let's pray. Father, thank you for rain. Thank you for the way it satisfies a thirsty earth. And Father, thank you for love and grace and how it satisfies a thirsty soul. Father, thank you for your comfort, satisfies a dry heart from sorrow. Thank you for unconditional love that satisfies a heart that is hurting from rejection. Father, simply thank you for you. It's what we're going to discover today in David's writing of Psalm 27. Thank you for you. We praise you, we honor you, we adore you. I trust not with just our lips, but more importantly, with an attitude of our heart. Father, we trust you with the needs that we've already spoken. We know you were listening, and we trust you for each of them. And those that we don't know about or those that maybe in our own humanity we forgot to mention, Father, we know you're big enough for the task. If there's someone who's walked in here today, Father, with hidden hurts and challenges of life, and they're just looking for something that might make a difference, I hope here in the context of these walls at a place called New Hope that they'll find your Son, the Lord Jesus. For it is Jesus who says, come to me when you're tired, weary, beaten down, battling the struggles of life. Come to me and find real rest for your souls. And Father, I hope we who are regular parts of New Hope's family, more importantly, those of us regular parts of your family, will allow our hands to be your hands, will allow our voice to be your voice, will allow our compassion to be your compassion that recognizes when somebody needs a touch, a word, hope. Father, for the privilege of giving today, it's an act of worship, Lord. It's not something that we do just because we want to pay the bills. It's from Genesis to Revelation. Giving is an act of worship. And Father, the way you receive our gifts is dependent upon the attitude in which we give them with. And we'll learn a little bit about that today out of Psalm 27. So Father, thank you for this moment. As we give, may we do so with great thought. we do so with great affection. May we do so with a desire, Father, to honor you. We trust you for all this in the mighty, matchless, and marvelous name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite you to turn to our next hymn this morning, found in Psalm 27. So if you would turn to Psalm 27, Milo couldn't have picked any better music than where we're going to be today than what he did. So great job, guys. Great job. Well, you're turning to Psalm 27. Just a quick refresher for those who might be new today. We're in a year-long series out of the book of Psalms. We are studying the Psalms to learn how to live a less, more lifestyle. Less of me, more of Christ. What John the Baptist said after he recognized his cousin as the Son of God, who said, "I must decrease so that he may increase." It's what Paul said when he wrote in the epistles, "I die daily. I am crucified with Christ so that it's not I who lives, but it's Christ who lives in and through me." And this less of me and more of him is an ongoing process that we never finish until God calls us home. And this lifestyle is a lifestyle that comes because we make a choice. It is a lifestyle that grows because we have a commitment to that choice. It is a lifestyle that is maintained because we're willing to be accountable to that choice and commitment. And it matures when we are engaged in the process of contemplation, the slow, thoughtful process of investigating the Scriptures. And the Psalms provide us the most contemplative passages in all the Bible, written primarily by David, but a few others, David and a guy named Asaph, and one or two others. And these are designed for us to sing and to contemplate about. So would you join with me as I read to you out of Psalm 27? Let's learn a little bit about contemplation. We won't read in a hurry. Let's read and think. He starts off right. The Lord. It's a great way to start. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? I wonder if David had in mind a moment in his past when he stood in front of Goliath. And he said, "The Lord is the stronghold of my life. He's big enough to take on the giant problems that I face." What giant is screaming at you today? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, though I'm outnumbered 1,000 to 1, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord. Obviously, David knew what was to be preeminent in his life. And he said, "One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life." Why do you want to dwell there, David? I want to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and I want to seek Him, to discover Him, to know Him in His temple. For in the days of trouble, He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of the tabernacle. And He will set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted. I will have confidence above the enemies who surround me. When surrounded, David sang, "At His tabernacle will I sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek your face. Your face, O Lord, I will seek. Do not hide it from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me. Do not forsake me, O God, my Savior. Though my father and my mother forsake me, you, the Lord, will receive me. Teach me. Teach me your way, O Lord. When's the last time in prayer you said, Lord, I'm teachable? Or teach me. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. People want to distract us. So, Lord, keep me on the straight path. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me and they breathe out violence. I am still confident of this. In spite of the armies, in spite of being outnumbered, in spite of facing overwhelming odds, I'm still confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. In the Amplified Version, it says, what would have become of me if I had not believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living? And then if it ended right there, it would have been good. But there's one more verse, and it might be the hardest verse of all. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart. Wait. Do not run ahead of the Lord. As his parents watched from a patio, a little boy played baseball by himself in the backyard. Of course, this amounted to tossing a ball into the air and attempting to hit it with his bat. As he did so, he proclaimed to nobody in particular, I am the greatest hitter in the world. Unfortunately, he missed the ball. And since he was the umpire as well, he yelled, strike one! Undaunted, though, the little fellow picked up the ball, threw it back in the air, and said, I am the greatest hitter in the world. And he missed the ball again. Strike two! The boy paused a moment, examined the bat very carefully, and then for a third time he threw the ball into the air. I'm the greatest hitter in the history of baseball! This time he swung for all he was worth, but just like his previous two attempts, he missed. Strike three! He mumbled. Then the boy sat for a moment considering what had just happened. After a minute or so, he turned to his parents, and much to their surprise, he said, wow, I just struck out the greatest hitter in the world. I must be the greatest pitcher in the world. I love that boy. I love his attitude. What that story illustrates for us is that attitude really does matter when we face difficult circumstances. It makes the difference between a good day and a bad day. Attitude often makes the difference between a good marriage and a bad marriage. Perhaps attitude makes a difference in a good working situation and a poor one. It makes a difference between a good life and a bad life. I will suggest to you it even makes a difference between good worship and lousy worship. Chuck Swindoll, my favorite pastor of all time, says, words can never adequately convey the incredible impact of our attitude towards life. The longer that I live, the more convinced I become that life is 10% what happens to us and 90% how we respond to it. I think David thought the same thing. And I think it is that attitude that may have prompted him to have written Psalm 27. Have you ever considered that your choice of attitude affects your daily life, your daily work, your daily spiritual growth and maturity, your ministry, and all of you have a ministry? If you are a child of God, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you have ministry. Have you even gone so far as to think that your attitude impacts the way in which you worship today and the benefit and blessings that will be yours as a result of your worship today? In Psalm 27, David begins by expressing his confidence in God in view of some of the worst circumstances you could ever imagine. This declaration of faith is written in the context of an attack that's going on from without by his enemies. What might have caused fear and anxiety in somebody who did not have absolute trust in God results only in the longing of David to be stronger and committed to his faith in God Himself. Let's walk for a few minutes through these first three verses and make some observations that if we're not careful, we would run right past. The very first thing, in the first two words, the Lord, the first thing David does is to establish for his readers, for the singers of this psalm, the object of his faith as the source of victory over his fears. As you face fearful moments in your life, who or what is the object of your faith to overcome those fears? We all know the right answer is Jesus. But sometimes the right answer is not always our answer. Sometimes it's our previous experience. Sometimes it's our gunslinger attitude. Sometimes it's positive thinking. Sometimes it's an I don't care attitude. But David clarifies the way I deal with fear. David doesn't tell us that he's not afraid. Completely. David tells us there's a way to deal with fear. It's kind of like John Wayne saying, courage is not the absence of fear, it's saddling up anyway. And David is telling us how he saddles up anyway. He saddles up in a seat with God. He puts his confidence in Him. The Lord, that phrase, those two words are used 13 times in 14 verses in this psalm. 13 times. You can count them up. Twice in verse 1, three times in verse 4, once in verse 7, verse 8, verse 10, verse 11, verse 13, and then he wraps it up two more times in verse 14. So it begins and ends, all right, with twins, the Lord. He wants to be clear that what gets him through the insurmountable obstacles of his life is his confidence in God. What are the things that create fear for us? May I just suggest a few? A lot of our fears are wrapped up in the future. We're afraid of our tomorrows. Will I live? Will I have enough? Will things turn out the way I want to? You see, we're afraid because the future is dark to us. We can't see that far ahead. And you know what David says? The Lord is my light. And He shines a light into my path. And though I may not be able to see clearly, His light will show me what I need to see when I need to see it. The Lord is my light into the future. He will provide guidance. Sometimes our fears are about our past. We're afraid of the things that we have done and the things that have been done to us, that they are irreparable. David gives us the solution to that fear. He says, "The Lord is my salvation." He is the one who forgives us. So that whatever I have done or whatever has been done to me does not have to scar me forever. It may have done some damage, but God is in the restoration business. He is in the transformation business. And He will restore and transform us by His forgiveness. And let's be honest. A lot of us are afraid about where we are right now in life. We're afraid of the present. And notice what David says. He says, "The Lord is the stronghold of my life. And in Him, I don't even have to be afraid of Goliath." Do you know who I think caused David the greatest fear? This is a personal opinion. Do you know who I think caused David the greatest fear in his life? I think it was his son, Absalom. Absalom, had he lived, not hung himself in a tree, Absalom would have been the next king of Israel. And I think the greatest fear that David probably ever experienced was the fear that he had for a son, not so much of Absalom's betrayal of David, though that was enough. But I think there was the real fear of a father for his child that he had rejected God. That by his actions, he had rejected God. And David said, even in the face of those kind of fears, I will not allow the fears to win. I will put my trust, my faith in God. Those who've grown up in the church and were familiar with all the laws of God, sometimes in Israel, a nation, when Jesus came, they lived by the laws, and Jesus came to bring to them some grace that would temper the laws. Not that the laws weren't right and just, but law just for law's sake is unwieldy. Laws are given so that relationships can be healthy. But when we go by sometimes the law without the grace that God intends for it, then we become robotic, and that's the way Israel had become. And so I think the scripture tells us, don't be afraid of the law of God. Why? Because the law has been satisfied in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. Don't be afraid of Satan, though he roars around this world like a lion looking for whom he can devour. Don't be afraid. Why? Because he's been conquered. He's toothless. He can't hurt you anymore. Don't be afraid of afflictions. There's going to be plenty of those in this world, but they've all been sanctified. God's going to use every one of our afflictions in our life for our good and for His glory. We can trust Him with that. Don't be afraid of death. We're all going to face it, and yet death has been overcome. That's what an empty tomb reminds us of. Remember, Romans 8:31, if God be for us, who can be against us? Okay, I gave you the shortest verse of the Bible a few weeks ago, remember? Jesus wept. See, some of y'all memorized that one. I think you can memorize this one, okay? Romans 8:31. If God be for us, who can be against us? Let's say it out loud together. If God be for us, who can be against us? That's Romans 8:31. Write that one down. If you haven't memorized it, write that one down. You can do that one this week, I'm confident. Now, here's what fear causes us to do. Fear causes us to hear things that are not there. Do you remember the first time your parents left you home alone without a babysitter at night? You've been begging them for months to do that. You've been saying, oh, Mom, I don't need a babysitter. I'm 10. And the first time they finally say, okay, you don't need a babysitter. We'll be back in 2 hours, okay? Here's the number. Gave you the list. Here's how you lock the doors. Don't let anybody in, all right? They went through that whole rigmarole. And the night they leave you alone, it storms. And you hear the branches moving on the roof of the house, and you think somebody's coming down the chimney, and it's not Santa Claus. You hear the door rattle. There's nobody there. You hear noises from under the bed. You don't open a closet door because you just know there's a monster inside. You see, that's what fear does. It prompts us to hear things that are not there, and it does the same thing spiritually, inwardly, emotionally. We hear voices telling us, you're not worth anything. You're of no value. You're a hypocrite. And there's nobody there. We also imagine things bigger than they really are. Mountains are made out of molehills, and monsters come out of our shadows. And then fear prompts us to feel things that are harmful to us. We feel self-loathing. We feel anger. We feel bitterness. We feel betrayal when it really hasn't happened. That's what fear does to us. But faith in Christ causes us to hear the whisper of God that we would not hear otherwise when God says, do not be afraid, for I am with you. Shh. Do you hear Him whispering to you? what you're facing right now, he's saying, don't be afraid. I am with you. I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Faith in Christ enables us to see things that fear would have made us miss. We get to see God's handiwork in the most peculiar ways. We get to see God's handiwork in a wedding dress, given for a noble cause that we would not have seen any other way. We get to see God's handiwork when we've been hurt and damaged by those who love us. We get to see how God didn't waste what others intended for evil. God said, I will use it. I will use it for good if you'll let me. And faith in Christ enables us to feel things very different than fear does. Faith enables us to feel joy that's only described as unspeakable. Faith enables us to sense love that is unconditional. Faith in Christ enables us to possess peace like a river in the midst of uncertain times. Martin Luther, he made this interesting observation in his book called Table Talk. He said, God and the devil take opposite sides and tactics in regard to fear. The Lord may allow us to be afraid that he might relieve our fears and give us comfort. The devil, on the other hand, makes us feel secure in our pride and our sins that we might later be overwhelmed with fear and despair. Okay, once David establishes the object of his faith, he then declares the primary purpose of all of his life. And he says, it is worship. That is found in verse 4. One thing I ask, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may gaze upon his beauty and seek him in his temple. This is remarkable. David was the king of Israel. He was the leader of armies. He was the deliverer of the word of God. And the pressures associated with any of these responsibilities would be more than most of us are capable of bearing. So how does David hold it all together? He says, I do so by maintaining an attitude of worship. Let's take just a couple of minutes and break down what David had to say about this all-important pursuit of worship. And we do that when we're not afraid. We worship when we are filled with faith in Christ. There's the discipline of worship, the destination of worship, the duration of worship, and the desire of worship. Pretty good alliteration, huh? That was fun. I'm not going to spend long on any one of them. The discipline of worship. To be a person who truly worships the Lord Jesus, this is a personal commitment of discipline. In a day and age when so many things compete for our attention, we can be consumed with the many duties that we have to take on. And David had a lot of duties, but he said there's only one thing. This was not a priority amongst priorities. This was the preeminent thing in David's life. There's only one thing I seek. And that is whether I am doing my job as a king, whether I'm doing my job as a husband, whether I'm fulfilling my responsibilities as a father, whether I'm fulfilling my obligations as a general of an army, there's only one thing I seek. And that is the Lord. Only one thing. I want to worship him. Do you remember the run-in that David had with Goliath in 1 Samuel? I believe it's chapter 17. While all the other soldiers could only see the situation from a human and hopeless perspective, David, as a worshiper of God, did not fall victim to such thinking. He was willing to oppose Goliath, not because he was stronger or more experienced, but because he was highly motivated by his love and adoration of God. David was offended by the arrogance of Goliath and his unwillingness to acknowledge the greatness of the God that he worshiped. Goliath could have ridiculed the armies of Israel. They could have ridiculed David himself. I think they probably could have even made fun of David's mother. But nothing drew the young man's irritation like the unwillingness for this uncircumcised Philistine to not respect and to honor his God. We could say that David was obsessed with worship. He had made the choice. He had offered a commitment. He was willing to be held accountable. And obviously, he wrote most of the Psalms. He understood contemplation. How important is it that we, as members of God's family, maintain this important discipline of worship? We must be careful not to lose that perspective when we are confronted with things that might create fear. You see, we exist to glorify Him. We cannot worship who we do not know, and we will not know God if our primary ambition is to worship human-invented, human-motivated, and human-enticing stuff. May we avoid the tyranny of our times by disciplining our minds to think as David did. One thing I ask, this is what I seek. What Simple question for you. What's the one thing you desire more than anything else today? You see, we should worship personally and collectively. We should worship privately and publicly. We should worship inwardly and outwardly. We should worship daily, weekly, often. It's a good practice for eternity. Number two, the destination of worship. That I may dwell in the house of the Lord. David here was not referring to a tabernacle, the place where God dwelt, because that tabernacle was not a forever place. So when David said, I want to dwell in your home, God, what David really is saying, remember Psalm 23, verse 6? I want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever, present, progressive, continuous tense. It means I'm now dwelling in it, and I will also continue to dwell in it when I die. I grew up for the first 10 years of my life at 815 South Orange, between Butler and Ventura Streets. That's where I grew up. My parents then bought a house at 2913 East Northdale in Fresno off of Gettysburg and First Street. It was my home for the next 18 years at 815 South Orange? No. Though that's the home I grew up in. It's where my first memories come from. That was not my home. Why did my home change to 2913 East Northdale? Because my mom and dad lived there. My home was where my parents lived. My home now is where God lives. In the presence of God. And that's what David is saying here. The destination of my worship is to daily, for all of eternity, spend this in intimate relationship with God. When that isn't happening, one of two things has gone wrong. Either we're worshiping the wrong thing or we're worshiping for the wrong reason. The object of our worship is to be Jesus Christ and Him alone. The very first command in Exodus 23 is, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." What's our motivation for worship? The Lord, I want you to turn with me, and we got time. I'm going to go 5 minutes over. I'm just telling you now, okay? Genesis chapter 5. And I'm hot. Anybody else hot in here? No? Yeah? Okay. Okay. Only the inside ones, just a hair. Not the outside one. Don't do the outside one. Just the inside one. Just a hair. What, 1 degree down. Genesis chapter 4. It's obvious that after God removed Adam and Eve from their perfect environment in the Garden of Eden because of their sin, now they're living in a sin-influenced world. God taught Adam and Eve, obviously, about sacrifices. Because Cain and Abel in Genesis chapter 4 are offering sacrifices. So obviously there was instruction about gifts to the Lord in this arena of sacrifice, predating the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus on a cross. And I just want to jump in. We don't need to read about the sex life at Adam and Eve. That's the first verse of chapter 4. So verse 2. Later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. One was a shepherd, one was a farmer. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of his firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was angry and his face was downcast. And the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you mad? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right," listen to this, "sin is crouching at your door." This has to do with attitude right here. This is what all this is about. And you'll find out more about that in just a minute. This has to do with attitude. If you don't deal with your attitude, Cain, sin crouches at your door. You must master it. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and he killed him. And then the Lord said to Cain, "Where's your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" Do you think God didn't know where Abel was? You kind of notice a repeat of the kids from the parents. If you remember, God showed up in the garden not long after they had eaten from the tree that they weren't supposed to eat from. And God stands by a bush that they're hiding behind and he says, "Adam, Eve, where are you?" God knew right where they were, right? Now God says to Cain, "Hey, Cain, where's your brother?" God knew where his brother was. But here's what I want you to notice. Some people have said in the past that the reason Cain's offering wasn't accepted is because it was a grain offering. Well, man, you can go through the whole Old Testament and you'll find they're grain offerings. God accepts grain offerings. Here's what I want you to notice. This is about attitude. Notice the phrase used about the grain offerings of Cain. He brought some. Interpreted, he brought his leftovers. He brought some. Notice what's said about Abel's offering. He brought fat portions of firstborn. He was willing to, quote, take the risk. He didn't wait to see what he had left to bring it. Fat portions, extravagant love and affection. He wanted to please God with the sacrifice of his gifts. See, it is a matter of heart. Cain was not right with God. It was an obligatory offering that he gave. It's possible to engage in the worship of God in a way that is not pleasing to him. And maybe what we're offering to him is just some. What's left over instead of fat portions of firstborn regarding our time, our resources, and our attitudes. People seek access to the presence of God for many reasons, and often it's because we want something from Him. There is, however, one motive that is more right than all the others, and David says it here. He says, because I want to know Him. There was once an elderly woman who unfortunately was gradually losing her memory. Throughout her life, however, this woman had cherished and depended upon the Word of God, committing a lot of verses to memory, and her favorite verse was 2 Timothy 1:12. I know in whom I have believed, and I am convinced that He is able to guard that which I've entrusted to Him for that day. This woman became confined to a bed in a nursing home. Her family knew that she would never leave that nursing home again alive. As they visited, she would quote verses out loud to them, especially and most frequently 2 Timothy 1:2. But with the passing of time and the loss of her memory, even parts of that well-loved verse began to fade. One day it was shortened to, I know in who I believe, He'll guard what I've entrusted to Him. Then it was simply, what I have entrusted to Him. A few short days before her death, all she could remember was entrust to Him. Finally, in the last moments of her last day, there was only one word left to her memory. She whispered it again and again as she sat on the doorstep of heaven. Him. 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 It was all she had left, but that was all that she needed. The duration of worship, much like this sermon, all the days of my life. David could think of nothing better than to spend the rest of his days in this life and in the future in the presence of God. Worship is not a momentary experience. It is a lifelong pursuit. We worship God willingly. I will bless the Lord at all times. He writes that in Psalm 34:1-3. Worship is a free will offering to God. Oh my goodness, I just lost my sermon. I hit something. Hold on. I can do this. Here we go. We're good. There we are. Number two, we worship God continually. What did I do? Oh, okay. We worship God continually. We worship God personally. We worship God corporately. Last of all, the desire of worship. He said to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. David had two desires in worship. One, to see something. Two, to seek something. To see the beauty of the Lord. It is beyond words and it must be experienced to be understood. For me, it's different for every one of us. For me, music and God's Word usher me into places that nothing else can do. I love a good movie. I love God's Not Dead 2. Okay? I love a good movie. I loved Mel Gibson's. Yeah, that one. I loved it, man. Whew. Nothing ushers me personally than a good biblically based song. Just like Say Amen. The one last week, what's my song from last week? It's got to be part of my concert when I go to heaven. Yeah, I'm not a slave. Okay, those songs, I can't explain. They simply move me. Okay? And I try to be careful when I get moved by a song. One of the first things I think about is it biblically accurate? because I don't want to, it's easy for us to get moved by things that are not biblically accurate, and that leads us to error. So is that song rooted in God's truth? And when it is, oh man, and then a passage in the Bible can just take me to places I've never been before. Number two, to seek Him in His temple. The idea is to actively and passionately pursue God that we might know Him better and enjoy Him more. That's the desire described in Psalm 42:1 as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for You, O God. These two desires, that we could see His beauty. Oh, I missed a key thing. I lost my spot there. Okay, we're going to do this. 2 Chronicles. I got to do this. 2 Chronicles. It's right after 1 Chronicles, in case you're confused. 2 Chronicles 20. Okay, you don't need to turn there. I'm just going to read. This is a time when Israel is facing a massive army. They are about to be wiped out. Here's what it says in verse 12. For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon You, O Lord. Victory is impossible from their perspective, but God, we're focused on You. It's not by power, not by might, but by the Spirit of the living God. You drop on down to verse 15 and 16. Do not be afraid, God says to them, because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, it's God's. Leave the fighting to God. Verse 17, you will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions. What's that? Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will give you. And if you flip to the next page, guess what? Vast army got whooped. Just as Goliath fell, vast army fell. All right? So, but now conclusion. The two desires, that we could see His beauty and to seek Him out, are meant to have profound impact in the daily life of a believer. They are meant to produce a decreasing satisfaction with the things of this world and an insatiable desire for the presence of God in our lives. In his book, Sahara Unveiled, William Langenwich tells the story of an Algerian named Laglag and a companion whose truck broke down while crossing the desert. They nearly died in their 3 weeks waiting to be rescued. As their bodies became dehydrated, they found that they were willing to drink anything in the hopes of quenching their terrible thirst. The sun forced them underneath their truck into the shade where they dug a shallow trench. Day after day they laid there. They had food, but they did not eat it, fearing that it would intensify their thirst. Dehydration, not starvation, kills wanderers in the desert. How did these two men manage to survive? They drank rusty radiator water, which in effect is poison. What would make a person drink water mixed with residue from the engine and antifreeze? And the answer is simple: the overwhelming desire to live. What drives you and me to seek out God in His temple and to see His beauty? I think the answer is simple: the unquenchable desire to know God and to see Him in His glory, and know that He'll say to us, these battles are not yours. Stand firm and watch. David practiced three actions in these 14 verses. He declared praise. He declared what he knew about God. It's how he faced his fears. He requested petitions. He expressed to the Lord what he needed and what he desired. And what was required was patience. Didn't even have time to deal with that one. He warned himself and us today in verse 14 to not run ahead of God. Be willing to wait. Here's a kicker. A willingness to wait is an expression that we come to understand when we've learned something about grace. Because how long has God waited by His grace for you and me? Patience is the ability to sit back and wait for expected outcomes without anxiety, tension, or frustration. Wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. And your strength will be renewed. And the prophet Isaiah said, and on occasions, when you wait, not when you hurry, on occasions when you wait, you will mount up on wings like an eagle. On occasions, you'll be able to run like the deer and not grow tired. But if you wait, you will always be enabled by my strength to walk and never, ever faint. Are you about to faint? The Lord is your answer. Wait upon Him. Let's pray. Father, if this song had ended at verse 13, it would have been good. But you included verse 14, and now it becomes even more challenging. Those of us being raised in the 21st century, we don't like to wait. We want our stuff and our things and our feelings now. And yet David says, wait, and God will provide. So, Father, we need a greater measure of your grace so that we learn to wait better. You know what folks are facing who are here today and why you brought them here specifically for this psalm. I will trust you to do for them and in them and through them what they will allow you to do and what you know needs to be done. And I trust their permission will match their needs. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. Have a great afternoon, guys. See you next week. Roundup Sunday.